We're on the slate.
Oh, I was going to ask Britta something. Okay. Are we both going to ask for letters about snow shoveling and letters about inflation? I think we probably ought to ask for only one. That's an awful lot of letters to ask for. Let's not ask for inflation letters this time.
That's what they just said.
Okay.
That's not what you said, but...
Good morning. This is Monday, January 29th. It's today in Chicago. I'm Norman Mark, and I hope you're warm and dry anyway. We're beginning a five-part series today, today through Friday. We're going to be talking about money, about inflation and recession, and about what's going to be happening to your money in the future, and I hope you enjoy it. Before we get to the first part of our five-part series on money, a thought, as a matter of fact, an angry thought for a Monday morning. It seems to me that every time I turn the television set on, someone is playing tennis. The worst were some people playing tennis at Montego Bay in Jamaica, in shorts, sweating, girls in bathing suits. There I am up to here in snow, and these people are swatting tennis balls. After that, if you turn the dial a little bit, you can see someone in short sleeves putting a ball and playing golf. What kind of thing is that to present to us in Chicago, with the snow and the cold and everything like that? Now, what I think the television stations ought to do is present us sports such as people pushing a car down a side street in Chicago. The one-block car push should be an important sport on television. And I am Norman Mark. Anyway, we're going to be back talking about inflation and money in a moment after this.
Just talk to Norman.
Sure.
Count to 10.
Or... Okay. What is the first question that you're going to ask?
Right. Money. What's going to happen to your money? Are you going to have a job in the future? Will we have a recession or a depression? Or will we have both, a recession, a depression, and inflation? That's all three, I suppose. We're going to talk about that for the next 5 days because it's probably the most important topic in our lives. We're going to start out by talking with Bob Genetski. He is a vice president of the Harris Bank and an economist for the bank. Welcome to the show, Bob.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Let's start out with the instant question, since my first suggestion was pushing cars up side streets. Has there been or will there be any economic problem for Chicago of a permanent nature associated with the snowfall?
No, I don't believe that there's going to be any permanent problem. We've had difficulties with weather, freeze-ups, and things like this before. Normally what happens is that as soon as the weather turns good, all the sales that were not occurring during that period of very bitter weather are made up. Now, you and I hope that within another few weeks, hopefully that weather is going to turn better, and then the basic impact of that short-term freeze should be limited.
We're all assuming the Earth will continue to go around the sun and eventually we will warm up or some
such
thing.
I think we have to assume that. We're in a lot of trouble if we don't.
First, I want to congratulate you on being an economist that so far I've understood everything you've said. So
we talked about the weather.
Now, let's go to, you had a prediction in a paper that was issued on September 6th that there would be a recession in 1979.
That's right.
Now, how deep of a recession and how much will it hurt us?
It's very difficult for any economist to tell you how severe a recession is going to be. This is why so many economists will give you so many different answers with respect to the future. To be very frank, our tools are not that good with respect to gauging how bad a recession is going to be. What we're forced to do in trying to answer this question is to look at the political situation and try to imagine what sort of political response we're going to see with respect to government policies as the economy starts to turn bad, how much patience the government will have. And my judgment is that when the economy turns bad next year, the Carter administration...
Next year or this year?
I'm sorry, this year.
This year, okay.
The Carter administration, I keep forgetting, we're in 1979.
Right.
The Carter administration is not going to have a great deal of patience with the unemployment rate going up, with the loss of job opportunities, and as a result, the restraint in policy that they've started to put on the economy is going to quickly turn around. In my estimation, my best judgment, we're going to have another 180-degree turnaround in terms of the administration's policies.
And what does that mean? We're going to
lower the
interest rates? Or
you might recall 2 years ago when the president first took office, his main objective was to get people back to work. We had a fairly high unemployment rate of about 8% at that time, and he said that that was the most important objective. The top priority item was to get people back to work. Now, how do you do that? Well, one way in which you can do it, and the way in which he chose, is the government can start printing money, creating money at a very rapid pace. Historically, what's happened whenever the government has done that is we've seen a sharp increase in spending and sales in the economy, and eventually people get hired to produce the items to make up those sales.
Let's stop there for just a moment. You talk about printing money, which is kind of, it's very vague. I mean, I get paid the same amount of money every week, and yet that the value of that money depends on how much money the government prints somehow.
Oh, I believe so, right.
Now, you trace back, say go back to the Eisenhower period. At what rate were we printing new money then, and what was the inflation rate? And bring it up to today.
Okay. If we go back to the period, let's take it from the mid-50s to the mid-1960s. During that 10-year period, we had a very slow creation of money on the part of the government. They created money at a rate of about 2% per year. And the inflation rate at that time was also very low. For those who can think back and try to remember what was happening to the value of money, the inflation rate was 1.7% per year during that period from the mid-50s to the mid-60s. Now, the next 10 years was a different story. That's the mid-60s to the mid-70s. The government increased the money supply at an annual rate, a yearly rate, of 5.5% on average during that period. And lo and behold, if we look at the inflation, that too averaged 5.5% during those 10 years. And that was in spite of the fact that we had wage and price controls at one time during that period. We had crop failures with respect to the farms. We had an OPEC oil price increase of fourfold at one point in time. And still, we ended up with just the amount of inflation that we were printing money to accommodate.
So what's happening today? I mean, are they printing money at 10, 11%?
Well, this gets us back up to the 2 years ago period. We had a brief respite from inflation, although most people hardly remember it. Back in 1974 and 1975, in response to a very rapid rate of inflation, the government shifted its policies to fight inflation. And what they do is they print less money. And in the process, interest rates go up because everyone wants to clamor for credit, and there really isn't that much of it around. The interest rates go up, spending eventually goes down. We go into a recession, as we did then. And finally, with a long lag, like a year and a half or 2 years later, the inflation rate comes down. And that happened in 1976. We had a 4.8% rate of inflation, the lowest inflation rate that we've seen in the past 5 or 6 years.
So we're up to 76 now.
Up to 76.
Now, what I want to do, we're going to take a break here, and I want to find out what's happening today. Obviously, somebody's printing some money someplace, and it's not in my basement, but we'll find out if it's in Bob's or somebody else's after we take this break. This is a first of a five-part series on Today in Chicago on money. My guest is Bob Genetski, an economist and vice president for the Harris Bank. And before we took the break, we were talking about the money supply and how it affects inflation. Now, what is happening today? Are they printing money at about the rate of inflation today?
Well, you recall I said that with a lag, the money tends to impact prices and inflation. And we went through this recession or downturn in economic activity in 74, 75 to try and control the very rapid inflation at that time. But then government policies became very impatient with the high unemployment rate. And as a result, we printed more money in 1976 than we did in 1975. Then the government printed even more in 77 than in 76. And more in 78, at least up until September or October, than they had in 77. So we were constantly printing more and more money each year. And in the 6 months ending last September, the money supply was growing at an 11% rate of increase.
And son of a gun, that's just about the rate of inflation.
It's fairly close. Mm-hmm. The relationship is not perfect, but it's good enough to me to suggest that it's a good indication of what's going to happen to
now,
inflation.
Now, later in the week, we're going to have a gentleman, a Mr. Ruff, come by, R-U-F-F, not R-O-U-G-H, and he is going to predict a near total collapse, in which I believe he will say that what we ought to do for the coming bad times is stock up on ammunition and food and head for the countryside. Now, is your recession that you're predicting going to be a collapse?
I certainly hope not. As a matter of fact, I brought up one of Mr. Ruff's newsletters and presented it to my wife some time ago and just made her terribly upset about the situation. I don't think so. I think the odds of a total economic, social, political collapse are extremely low, like they're less than 5%.
Mm-hmm.
You can see an awful lot of evidence of when political, social, economic collapses occur, such as now in Iran. And the underlying fabric of society in those type of countries where those things happen, I believe, tends to be a lot weaker than the type of social fabric that we have here in the U.S. We have tremendous outlets for dissent. We still do have a democracy, although we're not always all satisfied with the way it works. But with those type of outlets, it's very unlikely, in my judgment, extremely unlikely, that we're going to get some sort of total economic collapse. So I disagree with that sort of projection entirely, and I don't believe we should spend an awful lot of our time and effort and assets in terms of trying to protect ourselves against such a calamity.
6 months food supply, not a year.
I don't think we need six months.
If we know we're coming into some sort of an economic downturn, a recession is your...
A mild economic downturn, similar to the type that occurs maybe once every 3 or 4 years, or has occurred once every three or four years.
What should you do? Should you now go deeper into debt, for instance, put another
Just the opposite.
You should pay off your...
Just the opposite.
All right, what should the average person do?
If a recession is imminent and we're about ready to go into an economic downturn, and my guess is that we're going to go into it roughly around mid-year. That's not a certainty. It's really a guess. It's a forecast. It's a judgment that I have.
You're not saying June 30th. You're saying roughly mid-year. All right.
Right. Roughly around that time. I think we're going to have a downturn, which means, in terms of what I'm talking about, there are less jobs going to be available. Mm-hmm. There will be less production, less output. Some people will be laid off. Overtime will be more difficult to come by for other people. And the unemployment rate will tend to move up. Right now it's about 6% of the labor force. I expect by year end it's going to be up somewhere around 7%. Mm-hmm. And into 1980 it'll get up to about 8%.
All right, so then what should you do now? Should you increase your savings? Should you go to a bank and borrow more money and buy some property?
Or? Okay, first of all, we're coming into what I would term the latter stage of a business expansion. Mm-hmm. Our economy has been expanding for 4 years now. In the latter stage, credit and money become very difficult to come by. They become very expensive, as we've seen with the sharp increases in interest rates. My advice to people would be, at this point in the business cycle, to the greatest extent possible, cut back on spending, start to save money or pay off debt, not to overextend yourself a lot further. Be prepared for the possibility that you may be laid off for a week or 2 weeks. Your industry might not be directly affected, but it might be indirectly affected from a strike in another industry, from slow demand in another
industry. Let me say that's odd for someone in a bank to say in the business of lending money. But what you're saying is we ought to put our chestnuts away for the possibility that we may have to live in our savings for a while.
I think it's a reasonable type of strategy for anyone to pursue, particularly at this time. Now, it's not always the type of strategy you want to pursue. The reason I say that this is a desirable strategy now is I had mentioned this acceleration and speed up in the growth in money up until the fall of last year. Now, starting with September and October, it appears that the president has turned around, the whole administration has turned around the emphasis of their policies. They're no longer trying to create more spending and create more job opportunities. Now, their top priority is to fight the inflation. And how do you fight the inflation? The only effective way is the same way we've always done it historically. Mm-hmm. That is, you slow down the creation of money so that you're simply not producing as much. And since September, we've mm-hmm. seen that type of policy. The money supply has slowed down tremendously to about a 4 or 5% rate of increase, about half what it was in the 6 months ending in September. The effect of this would be to slow down spending, mm-hmm. To create less job opportunities in the economy, and my guess is this will start to happen roughly about mid-year.
All right, let's break for the news, and we'll be back with more tips on what you can do in a coming predicted recession after the news. This is the first of five parts about money, inflation, recession, what's going to be happening in the future. My guest, Bob Genetski. Bob, what should we be going on the gold standard? We're going to have people here in the coming days that will say that allowing the government to print money and affect inflation the way you've outlined is folly. They will always print enough to get jobs so they get elected next time. Should we go on the gold standard?
I'm sympathetic to the idea that we should go on the gold standard. I think there are a number of problems that lead me on balance to come out and say that we shouldn't go on the gold standard. Let me explain what they are. One of the things is that who decides whether or not we go on the gold standard? Well, it's Congress. And if Congress decides to go on the gold standard because all of a sudden they've got religion in mm-hmm. terms of controlling the amount of money and controlling inflation, they can also turn around and decide that they're going to go off the gold standard, because they really control the laws and they control pretty much what we do. Another thing that we have to think about very seriously is the reason we came off the gold standard in the first place. The problem that we ran into was that whenever we had a downturn in the economy and credit would become very difficult, the government had no control over the money supply. They had no control over giving the banks more liquidity, more credit, so that a mild downturn didn't accumulate into a very steep downturn.
So is that why in history books we see the panic of 1837 or whatever?
Exactly.
That it was a panic at that time.
Yeah, well, it was a panic because as soon as things started to dry up, the government did not have the power to come in and give the banks the extra liquidity, mm-hmm. the extra credit that might be needed to prevent
a
downturn.
All right, so we'll stay off the gold supply, but should I own a hunk of gold, an ingot? Should I own more gold than is in my teeth right here, you know? Well, I need this later on to cash in.
Gold is a very speculative type of commodity. If you hold it at the right time, you're going to get rich if you hold enough of it at the right time. If you hold it at the wrong time, you're going to lose an awful lot of the wealth that you're holding in the
form of gold. Is this the right or the wrong time?
I think this is the wrong time to be holding gold. Let me explain why. Right now, as I mentioned before, we're starting to see a slowdown in the growth of money. Restrictive policies are being put into place. Normally, after a very short period like this, when we go into a recession, this has been the worst time for commodity prices and gold. They tend to go down, and they tend to go down very sharply. Mm-hmm. Similarly, just as you start to speed up the growth in money, encourage spending and encourage higher inflation, you tend to see very sharp increases in gold prices.
I tell you what, we'll call you back to predict that, all right? Bob Genetski, thank you very much. We are trying to get some sidewalks clean in this town, and we've got a sidewalk campaign going on, and I received a letter from, of all places, the Gold Coast. They say the following single-family dwellings on Astor and Schiller Streets have never removed snow from sidewalks running parallel to their homes. This is especially irritating when one realizes these people have plowed their entryways to the curb so they can have easy access to chauffeurs, taxis, buses for their children, and delivery people. Well, what I'm going to do is not mention the exact addresses right now. We'll give a general area where these people are and hope that it'll embarrass them enough to clean their sidewalks. Otherwise, next time we will mention the address. So the 1400 block of North Astor, that's on the east side of the street near the corner, and on the west side of the street just off the corner, and Schiller near the middle of the block. Now, if you want to embarrass someone to get their sidewalks done or get your street done, send us a note over here, include your phone number so we can call you and make sure the letter is for real, and we'll try to get your sidewalk shoveled. As I said, we're in the middle of a five-part series now on inflation, on money, and what's going to happen, and I hope you're with us for the rest of them through Friday. stay tuned for the Today Show. I'm Norman Mark, and I hope you have yourself a great warm and dry day. Take care of yourself.